Please open your books up to page 68. Before we get into the substance of the sex inventory, let's quickly review how we got here. This is, of course, the fourth step, and it is the fourth part of the fourth step. The first three parts we've covered in some detail. The first part of the fourth step is the resentment inventory. Second part is an inventory of our own wrongs, our own faults. The third part is a fears inventory. Each of those was designed to elicit information and knowledge on our part, provided we were scrupulously honest, about specific defects of character. In the first part, of course, resentments are identified, as well as fears that were the cause of the resentments. Along with this, we were given the spiritual solution to resentment, which in shortest possible way of expression it is that we pray for those whom we resent, and that we pray for the willingness to forgive the wrongs that were done us. The second part of the fourth step is designed specifically for us to identify our dishonesty and selfishness, and again our fears, as these relate to our relationships with those whom we resented. In the doing of this, we are able to isolate these three defects of character. The third part of the fourth step concerns itself with our fears and with the spiritual solution to fear. It's very interesting to see how much we accomplish when we do our fourth step and do it properly. We lose the resentments we walked in the door with. We gain invaluable knowledge about ourselves, which means that we are able now to discern what our present circumstances are. What are the facts about us today? And to do that, we look at our past and we identify our defects and our guilts as a result of that. In the fears inventory, we learn how to stay free of fear. At least we learn a good part of that formula. The rest of it we will learn when we get to our fifth step, which literally means that we now, by the time we finish our fifth step, we know how to be free of fear. Whenever fear comes up, we're able to deal with it because we have a spiritual solution to it. The fourth part of the fourth step, dealing with our sex inventory, specifically identifies our dishonesties and our selfishness. It applies to our relationships with others in sex relations, and by extension, it really teaches us where we have failed in our relationships with all people. Because the answers that we give in our sex relationships are analogs of our relationships with all people. What we get to learn from this not only is what is wrong with us that needs to be corrected, but also we get to a close-up view of the people we've harmed as a result of our relationships with them in our sex relations. This adds, of course, to our list of people we've harmed. Another outcome from the fourth step, which most people see it in the book but perhaps do not equate it, is that when we have finished these four parts of the fourth step, we will have completed most of our eighth step. We will have identified the people we've harmed, and we will have become willing and ready to make amends where we can. So now we've reached the fourth part, the sex inventory, and this is a critically important part of the fourth step. It is not to be sloughed over. It's going to be apparent when you're teaching others or when you do your own inventory that some of the really relevant material in the fourth, in the sex inventory has already been covered when you did your resentment list or when you did the list of your wrongs directed toward other people. Nevertheless, the questions which are covered in the fourth part, the sex inventory, are much more inclusive, and you have to be careful not to slop over them just because some of this material is already covered in prior sections. In other words, all these things fit directly together, so you cannot separate out one part from another and say that it stands exclusively alone. And that's true of every one of our steps and every part of our steps. They all fit together. It's like a fine mosaic. If you take one or two tiles out of a mosaic, you no longer have a complete picture. We make a mistake when we try to isolate the steps and set them apart as if they were separate entities. None of them are. Each step we take builds toward the ones to follow, and those build upon the ones that preceded them. And so we have a continuum, and we don't dare isolate any step out and try to make it as a freestanding situation. And some of the things that we find in other literature other than the Big Book, that's precisely what is attempted, and it doesn't work, because if we're trying to make a step stand alone, we forget, or we don't acknowledge or compute in what's already come before and what must come after. It's likewise with this sex inventory. It does not stand alone, but it's extremely important because it deals with some of the most difficult parts of the human psyche, and perhaps the most powerful of our natural instincts. We've already discussed the God-given natural instincts in the past, but it pays well for us to keep these in mind, because this forms the nexus of our approach to our insanity. We have to understand what's happened here. God has given us three natural instincts. Remember again, an instinct operates below the level of conscious thought. That's why we call it an instinct. Our reactions are instinctual, we say. In other words, we take them without thinking. Many of the reactions are purely physical. And for example, the sexual arousal is physical as well as mental, and both seem to operate independently of any conscious thought. In other words, to be aroused sexually, we don't have to first think, now I'm going to get aroused. It just happens. And we don't have any control over that. And so this is true across the board with our instincts. They operate from below the level of conscious thought. They probably emanate from the more ancient parts of our brain. And certainly these instincts are God-driven and God-given, because each and every one of them is designed for our protection, for the betterment of us individually, and also for the propagation, the perpetuation of the race. Were not for the powerful sex instinct, I suppose one could postulate there would be no humankind at all. We wouldn't exist. Now, when instincts are warped and perverted by fear, this is the insanity we speak of. Now, obviously, in the second step, when we come to believe that God can restore us to sanity, it's clear that in that context, we are speaking about the insanity of the next drink, or the insanity that will keep us drinking in spite of all of the contrary indications. All of our experience tells us don't drink. We're going to be in deep trouble if we do, but we do it anyway. The Big Book says, whatever else you might want to call this is insanity. But the insanity goes so much further than that, and it goes into our thinking processes. Our minds do not work as God intended them to work. When we come in the door here, we're nuts. we have a species of insanity, probably not the rubber room variety, maybe even not diagnosable by the most skilled psychiatrist, but it becomes pretty obvious as we do our four-step that our mind stopped functioning quite a long time ago in any rational way. Our thinking is screwed up. Now, in the second step, we came to believe that God could restore us to sanity, and in the tenth step, it tells us He will, that we will have been restored to sanity, but not without some effort on our part. And so, when we look at the God-given instincts for security, society, and sex, it seems fairly obvious that the instinct for sex is perhaps the most powerful of these three. Now, it's going to vary according to human beings, and it isn't necessary for us to categorize them or put them in any kind of an order. But suffice it to say that we have to recognize that this instinct is extremely powerful. What's the big book call it? The imperious urge. The imperium. You can visualize Napoleon going through the lowlands, or Genghis Khan defeating all of Asia and most of Europe, or the Roman legions. The imperium, the imperious urge, against which we have no defense. We are as powerless over the sex urge as we are over alcohol. Just as powerless over our sex instinct as we are over alcohol, or over resentments, or dishonesty, selfishness. All of these things are the products of our minds, and they relate to our instincts. And because they relate to our instincts, we don't have conscious control of them. That's why we're powerless over this stuff. Got to understand this. This is not some metaphysical or esoteric concept, this powerlessness. It's real. Just as real as we are. Our reality is that we have no power over our instinctual responses. Not on our own. Not without help. That's exactly why we're here. Because we've been insane. Our natural instincts, warped and perverted by fear, have stopped working for us. In order for us to be set free from this, we have to have God's help. That's why we're here. So when we look at the sex inventory, we have to look at it from the standpoint of dealing here with something of enormous power within the lives of our sponsees, and of course in our own lives. If you there are thousands and thousands of examples and indications and proofs of the enormous impact that the sex power, the sex instinct has on human lives. In many ways, it forms the basis of most advertising. People dress to be attractive to the opposite sex. Perfumes, cosmetics, toupees. Everywhere you look and everywhere you see the necessity, the apparent necessity of being appealing to the opposite sex, to be appealing to those that we want to have relationships with. And even though much of this is obviously subliminal, nevertheless, it's there. It's so much easier to sell a new bourbon with a beautiful woman being absolutely amazed by the gentleman who was perspicacious enough to offer her a drink of this new bourbon. And you see in her slinky dress and in the adoration in her eyes, just exactly what this bourbon did for this guy. Now, we all want that. This is something of enormous power, and it operates below the level of conscious thought. We don't say consciously, oh yes, that Johnny Walker, that's a wonderful scotch, because if I offer this wonderful scotch to a woman, she's going to fall in love with me immediately. This just doesn't happen. We recognize this below the level of conscious thought. If you want to sell a movie these days, you better have some sex in it, even if it is not overt. So we can go on and on with this, but we have to recognize that we're dealing here with something of enormous power, and something which only a higher power is going to be able to help us with. Now, it's important for us to understand when we approach this sex inventory that we're not here to make judgments, although there are those who are of a religious bent who may feel that they're called upon to call sin a sin if they see it. But I suppose for most of us, we follow the dictates of the big book, which tells us precisely the opposite, that we let God be the judge, and that we don't make those kinds of judgments about others. We even have to be careful about making those kinds of judgments about ourselves, because this can skew us away from the reality of what we're trying to do here. We're not dealing here with sin. We're dealing with a serious disruption in our brains. We're dealing with a form of insanity, a natural instinct gone awry, with the certain knowledge that we cannot be free of this without God's help. But our job first then is to identify the symptoms and the outcome of this sex instinct gone awry as a result of fear. Because before we can seek God's help, we're going to have to find out what the problem is and then admit it in our fifth step. And then in the seventh step, we take it to God and ask Him for help. And so if we look at the bottom of page 68, please. The last full partial paragraph, six lines up from the bottom of the page. Now about sex. Many of us needed an overhaul in there, but above all, we tried to be sensible on this question. It's so easy to get off the track. Here we find human opinions running to extremes, absurd extremes perhaps. One set of voices cry that sex is a lust of our lower nature, a base necessity for procreation. And of course, that would be the group that would insist that recreational sex is a sin by definition, and therefore the only sex we are permitted to have is that sex which is at the right time and for the right purpose and the right motives, which is to create a baby. And if you're doing it other than that, you're sinful. A base necessity of procreation. We don't like to do it. It's dirty, it's nasty, it's rotten, but we have to do it if we want to have kids. And anybody who doesn't believe that is a sinner and is obviously consigned to some hot spot in the lower regions. Then we have the voices who cry for sex and more sex, who bewail the institution of marriage, who think that most of the troubles of the race are traceable to sex causes. They think we do not have enough of it, or it isn't the right kind. They see its significance everywhere. Notice that this was written in 1938 or 1939, long before Playboy. There was a magazine called Esquire, and Esquire had a cartoon, not a photograph, but a cartoon in every issue, a very sexy-looking woman, actually totally pneumatic and beyond the possibilities of any human woman ever looking that way. But you see, what we've got here is a definition of precisely what the sex revolution supposedly started, but this was way before that. Also, it's a reflection of Bill Wilson's disdain, I suppose, for Freudian theory, which insisted that you could trace the root cause of all aberrant mental behavior or physical behavior to some kind of a sexual problem. And Freud made a whole career and founded a whole school of psychiatric practice, at least in part, on that idea. But then it goes on to say this. One school would allow a man no flavor for his fare. That's very 30s. Fare means food, what we eat, and flavor would mean that we don't get to put salt on it or pepper or any other seasoning. We just have to eat it like it came out of the ground or off the cow. One school allowed man no flavor for his fare. In other words, pap, bland, the kind of stuff that the naturists around among us insist that we're supposed to eat. And the other would have us all on a straight pepper diet. Everything that was titillating to the senses would be just fine. We want to stay out of this controversy. Listen to this now. We do not want to be the arbiter of anyone's sex conduct. How many times around these rooms do you think anybody pays attention to that? God. What is it that forms the basis of most gossip around here? We all have sex problems. It reminds me, right after it became popular to talk about dysfunctional families, I think that was about 10 or 12 years ago. And I was appalled. I had no idea that we were getting into that because it's irrelevant. Totally irrelevant to recovery. But nevertheless, because the psychodrama people had figured that one out and coined the phrase, I supposed that we were going to have to deal with it one way or another. And then I saw a book, the cover, just the cover of the book. It was written by some little master's degree psychologist or something, but it got out in the public somehow or another. And the title of the book was, I'm Dysfunctional, You're Dysfunctional, We're All Dysfunctional. Wow, that's probably true. We all have sex problems. We'd hardly be human if we didn't. Okay, now that's the problem. What can we do about them? Remember, every time the big book states the problem, it always, shortly thereafter, immediately thereafter, gives us a solution. So here's the solution. Next paragraph. Now, this little paragraph of six lines contains the fourth part of the fourth step. These are the directions for doing the sex inventory. And it, again, consists of a series of questions. And these are questions that we need to ask ourselves and to answer in writing. About whom? Well, it doesn't say, except the implication would be that we want to leave anybody out. So before we start answering these questions, we're going to need to make a list of all the people we ever had sex with. Now, that may be a problem for some of us, some of our sponsees. Others won't have any problem with it at all. If we're talking about people whose names are unknown or were never known or have been forgotten, it would be perfectly permissible to list them as Chicago 1, 2, and 3, and Miami A, B, and C. Because we don't have to have names here. We just need to go back and remember. This is just from me now. You can take it for what it's worth. I think it works well. Many people you sponsor will have had a lot of one-night stands, or two-night stands, but short, very short relationships, if you can call them that. Nevertheless, they were sexual contacts. I believe it's quite permissible to lump all of these one-night stands into one category because the answers to the questions are going to be basically the same. Nevertheless, we want as complete a list as possible. There are two reasons for this. We don't want to miss anything that may be lurking out there, and a lot of this stuff is subliminal. We've buried it pretty deeply. Probably some of it we don't remember too much about because we were in a blackout or whatever, but nevertheless, we're going to answer the questions the best we can. Likewise, there may be some people out there that we don't remember the names of, but who we hurt significantly. And even though we don't remember their names, we're still going to have to do something to make amends for the harm that we've done. So we're going to, in one way or another, we're going to identify them. And now, once we've done that, we've got questions here that we must answer about each and every one of these sexual yes.
Yeah, what is permissible?
What?
The word you just said, permissible, permissible, the word you just said, what does it mean?
Permissible?
Yeah, what does it mean?
It means it's okay to do it.
Okay.
It's permitted. It is permitted. It's okay. It's legal. It's lawful. You know, it's sanctioned. Okay? So we're going to answer these questions in writing, and we're going to answer them, some of them in a narrative form, just as we answered the questions in our resentment inventory and in our inventory of our own faults. Some of these questions we will see are yes and no. But we're going to answer these questions as best we can about everybody on our list. Please open your books up to page 69 now. Some of you may have heard this story. Maybe some of you have not. A lady who was relatively new became very, very enamored of a gentleman in her home group. She thought he was very cute and very nice and very smart and very spiritual, and she really, really wanted him to notice her. But he just wouldn't pay attention. He would say hi, but she couldn't get him to go any further than that. She was real upset about it. She went to her sponsor and she told her sponsor about it. The sponsor said, "Well, all the answers you need are right there in your big book on page 69. So when she got home that night, she decided she'd look it up, but she couldn't remember the page number. Then it came to her. Oh yes, page 96. So she opened it up to page 96. And guess what it said? Do not be discouraged if your prospect does not respond at once. Search out another alcoholic and try again. You're sure to find someone desperate enough to accept with eagerness what you offer. To spend too much time on anyone's situation is to deny some other alcoholic an opportunity to live and be happy." She thought, wow, what great advice. Okay, so now we have our list of all the people with whom we have had relationships. Now we're going to answer the questions on page 69 in the first full paragraph, about a third of the way down the page. We reviewed our own conduct over the years past. Now here are the questions. Notice that the sentence begins with the word "where." It does not ask us, "Was I?" It asks us, "Where was I? Selfish, dishonest, or inconsiderate?" So now the way we're going to answer this is, let's assume that the first on our list is Mr. or Ms. X. Now, with respect to X, where had I been selfish in my relationship with X? So we're going to write down our actions and our motivations and our attitudes that were selfish. When we finish that, we go back to X again. With respect to X, where had I been dishonest? Again, a narrative description of our dishonesty, our dishonest motives, our dishonest actions, our dishonest attitudes. And finally, with respect to X, where had I been inconsiderate? Of course, we recognize, I hope, that inconsiderateness, being inconsiderate, is simply another expression or a part of our selfishness. Now the next question, with respect to X, whom did I hurt? Did I hurt X? Now this is a pretty important question, because a lot of times in the state of mind that we had before we came in the room, before we started getting honest with ourselves, our first inclination would be to say, well, she knew what she was getting into, or he had no doubt about what was going on. And he was just as guilty as I was, and I don't think I hurt him at all. And we can rationalize just about any action based on that. You got to be careful of that with your sponsees. There's a better way, the way to look at it, and this is the way we look at all of our 8-step, not just here, but across the board. If that was done to me, would I be hurt? See, that's the only true test we have, because the moment that we begin trying to guess whether the other person would have been hurt by our actions, we put ourselves beyond the pale. That's fertile ground for rationalization and denial and self-delusion. So we're going to ask ourselves, whom had I hurt? And the test is, if what I did would have hurt me, I'm going to write down their names. Now, with respect to X, did I unjustifiably, a very interesting word. Of course, it means exactly what it says, but we have to again be careful of justification. Self-justification is one of our many character flaws. It's easy for us to justify our actions based upon our perception of what others have done to us, or upon what we are entitled to. You know, people have pumped us all through with this idea of entitlement, and that we're supposed to have this, we're supposed to have that, we're supposed to be happy. People are supposed to treat us in a certain way, and on. If they do not, then it is justified for us to retaliate. Now, if we start to think about this justification from the standpoint of retaliation, then we understand what it really means. Retaliation we ran into back in our resentment list, didn't we? And all the way back in the 3rd step, that we step on the toes of our fellows and they retaliate, seemingly without provocation. In the 4th step, in the resentment list, when we looked at the solution to resentments, we realized that we had spent a lot of time retaliating, justifiably taking action against others whom we resented. It's the same kind of thing that we hear from the human solutionists, who tell us that some anger is justified, some resentments are justified. What that ignores absolutely is that the anger or the resentment blocks us from God and will kill us. Who cares if it's justified or not? The justification is something that we whomped up. Now then, when we look at this, unjustifiably, there was no reason for us to do the things we did. We had no possible justification for it. See, this is just the opposite of being justified, isn't it? Unjustifiably, we had no right to do these things. We were not permitted. Did we unjustifiably arouse jealousy, suspicion, or bitterness? Think about that. I'm going to get back at you. I'm going to make you jealous. I'm going to get back at you. I'm going to let you see what the bitter taste of a love affair gone sour can be. You get to suffer along with me. I'm going to make you suspicious just as you've made me suspicious. Now, of course, justification for bitterness, suspicion, and jealousy is that the other person has done something to us. Or, even worse, that these are techniques that we use for control. We've learned how to push the hot buttons of the other person. If we want to control Mr. X, we make him jealous. Now he will pay a lot more attention to us. If he suspects maybe that we're doing something behind his back, maybe he'll pay more attention. Maybe we'll drag him into our fold even more. You see, what we've been taught right from the time we were kids is that we build a castle. And when we have a relationship with somebody, we bring them into that castle and we take them captive. And there are all kinds of ways of doing that. None of these are justified in the sense that there is no spiritual justification for it, especially in light of the fact that by doing this we harm ourselves probably even more than we harm the other person, especially in view of the fact that to do this we have to blind ourselves to the realities, to the truth about us. Remember again, see, all this stuff ties together. Every time you hear chapter 5 being read, the first paragraph tells us that we cannot recover if we're unwilling or unable to be honest with ourselves. This is another indication that we have been self-deluded, that we've been dishonest with ourselves, and these are things that we have to deal with. And this dishonesty is the dishonesty that the Big Book talks about. Seldom do we have even the slightest indication that the Big Book is talking in terms of honesty, is talking about cash register honesty. It's talking about self-honesty. All the way through, the criteria for recovery is that we be honest with ourselves and with God and with another human being. But it all starts with self-honesty, and it all starts right here in the fourth step. Anybody have any problem with that? Yes.
I don't know if it's a problem. I'm not understanding the whole justifiably, unjustifiably when it comes to arousing these emotions or feelings in someone else.
The term unjustifiably here is intended to call our attention to the fact that we're never justified to do this. That's what it means. It doesn't mean that we're to apply some non-existent standard, either justified or not justified. The fact is that every time we do this, we harm ourselves. We perpetuate a resentment or an anger. We perpetuate a situation where we've been dishonest. We certainly perpetuate our selfishness and self-centeredness by doing this. And it goes directly against the cardinal principle that we find in the 10th step, the love and tolerance of others is our code. We're not exhibiting any kind of love by doing this. We're going directly against spiritual principles. It can never be justified. Does that make sense?
It does. And then when I did this, I was hung up on that word, and so I just pretended it wasn't there and broke down.
Yeah, well, that's why we have to parse each sentence and each word. Each word is important in the Big Book.
Right.
Every phrase, every sentence, every paragraph, regardless of where you find it in the book, in the first 164 pages. Because we're talking about an inspired document, and probably the most dense writing you'll ever find. Those who have been around for a while, Tom will tell you, he's been a student of the Big Book, and as we continue to go through these together, he and I both keep finding connections we never saw before.
Right.
had a question about fear. There's a lot of talk in the rooms about healthy fears. I'm afraid that I'll forget my last drink because then means I might not have had it. And a lot of these fears, it makes sense to me because I can remember when I was early in the program, I was afraid. I had this thing in my gut about what I did, where I was, and I just want to go back. And yet, if you take what you said about anger and jealousy blocks us from God, well, fear is in that category too.
Oh, absolutely.
But I still think, before I put my hand down something in a hole in the ground or something, I'm going to be afraid that there might be snakes down there. So I might put a glove or something, So I can't balance this healthy fear blocking me from God and these unhealthy fears, like if I lose Susie or something, you know what I mean? I can see the unhealthy fears, but I believe in healthy fears.
Okay. Let's examine that for a second. Is it your experience that when you put your hand down a hole that there's a snake in it?
No, because I'm still alive.
Okay. Somebody may have told you at one time that snakes live in holes?
Yeah, I've seen them in holes.
Okay. And so, since there might be a snake in that hole, why would anybody with any degree of rationality put their hand in it?
Turn off the water? Pick up a dollar. I don't know. A lot of things that fall in holes.
Okay. What we have to be aware of here, Tom, is that we do not stay sober on the fear of getting drunk and the consequences of getting drunk. This is one of the most important things for us to recognize.
Can we get sober on that fear?
No. Well, it'll probably drag us in here. It may even be sufficient for us to be willing to work the steps. But the only solution we have in here is the steps, and the steps abdicate the whole idea of fear being anything but an absolute monster in our lives. That the fabric of our lives is shot through with it. And fear is our enemy. It's the only enemy we have. Fear is the progenitor and the trigger mechanism for all of our defects of character. Fear is what has warped and perverted our natural instincts.
There's no healthy fear.
There is no healthy fear in the sense that we're talking about. We're talking about fear here, which is a phantom, which is a product of our minds, which is something our minds manufacture. It has no reality because it deals with something that might happen in the future. We must distinguish that from caution. It's not the same thing as saying, I'm not going to put my hand on a hot stove. We're not talking about that kind of fear. That's something which is, there's no doubt about it. There might be a snake in that hole. If there is, you're going to get bitten and you may die. You sure don't put your hand on a hot stove, you know you're going to get burned. We're not talking about that kind of caution. There are things that we just simply don't do because it makes no sense to do them. There's too much risk involved. Risk does not equate to fear. If you go out on I-95, you're very careful because it's a dangerous road. That doesn't mean you're afraid to go there. It means that when you go there, you're cautious about what you do. You watch the other guys. You watch the right front wheel of the guy who's next to you on your left, because the wheel will turn before the car does. You watch in your rearview mirror to see some idiot coming up behind you at 100 miles an hour. He's going to kill you if you happen to change lanes in front of him. You've got a 10-foot lane, so you're very careful to stay in the middle of it. But that doesn't mean you're afraid to go on I-95. Of course, there are some people who are. There are people afraid to fly. There are people afraid to sit in a room by themselves. It's people afraid of the dark. We're not talking here about phobias either. We're talking about the concept that if I am afraid of something which may happen in the future, that's going to keep me from doing what will cause that to happen. In spite of the fact that I am crazy, I am insane, I am obsessed, and I have a compulsion, fear is never enough to override those. You see, fear is operating at a conscious level. Our defects operate at a subconscious level, below the level of conscious thought. So the fact that we have all kinds of fear is not going to militate against us taking the next drink. It just doesn't. It can be enough, and sometimes is enough, to get us in here and get us going. You look at the stories of Jim and Fred in chapter 3, you find perfect examples of that. Both of these guys were afraid of the consequences of the next drink. They had plenty of experience in what was going to happen. But the boys had told them the truth. There will come a time, no matter how much you know about yourself or how much you're afraid of the consequences of the next drink, there will come a time when nothing will stand between you and the booze. And if you don't have a loving God there, you will drink again. And they told them both, you may very well do this without any thought whatsoever. The thought of the consequences will not enter your mind. And so for us to count upon that as somehow the silver bullet to keep us from drinking is a total fool's paradise. As a matter of fact, the Big Book makes it very clear that we've not even sworn up. Never once does it tell us don't drink. Why would it tell us to do something we can't not do? It says, find God. Get a loving God between you and the booze. It's the only solution we offer here. Make sense?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. So now then, this unjustifiably stuff. Everybody understand that? Okay. Next question is another question we must answer in narrative form. Where were we at fault, and what should we have done instead? These are questions which are a precursor to what we're going to be doing every day of our lives when we get to our 11-step inventory. We're going to be looking at our day and see what we could have done instead. We're going to see what our next action should have been. We're going to see where we've gotten off the path. Where were we at fault, and what should we have done instead? Extremely important questions. Now, this is with respect to Mr. or Ms. X. We're going to answer those same questions all the way down the line with everybody on our list. And we got this all down on paper and looked at it. In this way, we tried to shape a sane and sound ideal for our future sex life. We subjected each relation to this test. Was it selfish or not? Does that give us a clue as to what the critical factor in this inventory is? Of course it does. It's selfishness. Go back to the third step again. So our troubles we think of our own making. They arise out of ourselves, and the alcoholic is an extreme example of self-will run riot. Driven by 100 forms of fear, self-delusion, self-seeking, we stepped on the toes of our fellows and they retaliated. In other words, it's quite clear that the essence of the failure of our relationships with other people have been our selfishness and our self-centeredness and our self-centered fear and our self-delusion. And we're going to find that out as we do this inventory. We subjected each relation to this test. Was it selfish or not? Notice also that we're trying to shape a sane and sound ideal for our future life, future sex life. This does not mean our ideal mate. It has nothing to do with him or her out there. It has only to do with us. And in answering these questions, we have paraded the horribles. We have found out about ourselves. We have identified those things which have caused the failures of our relationships in the past. We've identified those actions and those motivations and those attitudes which have harmed others and have meant that we have never had that complete and satisfying and normal and rational and sane relationship with another human being. We're going to see that selfishness was involved in our relationships, that we were dishonest as a result of it, And that we never had a chance because the selfishness blocked God out of the equation. And as we go through the eighth and ninth chapters in the big book, the chapters that deal with the wives and the family afterward, we find out how critically important it is in a relationship to have a spiritual basis for it. One of the things that we're going to see, if we don't see it here, we're going to see it eventually, that where one person in a relationship is growing spiritually and the other one is not, that relationship is bound to fail. They may not break up, but they'll be damn miserable if they don't. They'll be damn miserable if they do. We're dealing here not with things that would be kind of nice, sort of like to do. These are spiritual principles that are universal, and they apply to all human beings, not just to us. The problem is we never knew it before. Oh, we may have been to church, we may have been told all this stuff, but nobody ever told us how to do it. Now, because we have the 12 steps, we have the actions we must take in order to ensure our success in our relationships in the future. So we're going to write this all down. It's very important for us to form this vision, this plan, this ideal for how we wish to conduct ourselves in the future. One thing that becomes apparent also is that when we craft this ideal, we are not only doing so for our future sex lives, but that this has carryover into our relationships with all people. We're going to be looking toward maintaining relationships unselfishly, without doing things to further our own aims, to feather our own nest, without having a relationship for what we can get out of it, but rather for what we can put into it. Unselfishness equates to loving giving, without demand of any kind for a return. And when you can have that with another human being, you got something that's priceless. There's no way you can measure it on any scale. It's priceless. We ask God to mold our ideals and help us live up to them. This is the keynote for this whole section. Not only have we found out what was wrong with us and whom we harmed, but we've found that we must take this to God and ask Him to show us how He would want us to live our lives, to mold our ideals. We don't try to do this alone. It's not a bad idea when you're working with your sponsees to have them write this ideal down in the form of a prayer. God, this is the ideal I have for my conduct in my future sex life. I need your help with this. I know that I'm powerless in many of these things, and please be with me and shine your light on me and show me how to live up to this ideal. And that works very well. This next sentence is so important to understand. We remembered always that our sex powers were God-given and therefore good. God-given and therefore good. Neither to be used lightly or selfishly, nor to be despised and loathed. And this means that regardless of the direction of our sexual orientation, the moment that we understand that our sex powers are God-given and therefore good, it relieves us of all of the anxieties, all of the terrors, and all of the people out there in society who do not understand that our sex powers are God-given. Now we can relax. But the one thing that we need to understand is that this principle only applies if we approach each sexual encounter or relationship unselfishly, and if we do not take them lightly. Remember that when we engage in sexual activities, we irrevocably change both parties. It'll never be the same relationship again. And each person who is a party to a sex relationship has the same kind of reaction, even though it may not be readily apparent. It's going on nevertheless. And because there are these significant changes and this radical influence of the sex act on others, you can understand why for us to engage in this lightly, as if it was of no consequence, can cause irreparable harm to the other person as well as to ourselves. Nor to be despised and loathed. God, we spend so much time in guilt-ridden about these things. One of the things that we always ask, and we'll be talking about this next week, or soon anyway, in our fifth step, as if we're hearing somebody's fifth step, before we are finished, we ask them, is there anything at all that we haven't talked about that is so disturbing to you that you're never going to allow another person to know about it, something you're going to carry to your grave? You don't have to tell me what it is, but you must tell me if something like that is still unspoken here, if you've been hiding it. About half the time, that will exist, and we have to ferret it out. Most of the time, there are two areas that are going to be of this disturbing. One is going to be some sort of criminal activity, which has never been discovered and goes unpunished. And the other will be homosexuality, and usually an isolated act when the person is a child. And this can be something that's been weighing on the person's mind all these years. So we know the power of this loathing and despising of our sex powers. It's very important that we help our sponsees to come past that. Now then, let's go to the next paragraph. Whatever our ideal turns out to be, we must be willing to grow toward it. We're going right back to the same ideal. Everybody understand that? This is the ideal we crafted with God's help. Yes.
I just want to add something about you asked, when we asked our sponsees if there's anything that they had left out, if it's criminal activity, it might be wise to think about before you ask them that question, whether or not you want to add, if there is some criminal activity that you left out, and you do want to tell another human being about it as part of your fifth step, maybe you should go to a priest, or someone that is protected by law, you know, to honor that privacy.
Yeah. I know to my great discomfort that that's true. And I spent 5 months in prison because I would not reveal what I'd been told. I could have saved myself all of that. On the other hand, here's the problem with that, Sue. The fifth step is given under a seal of absolute secrecy, never to be revealed to anyone, period. And at this point, you have probably gained the trust of the person you're hearing the fifth step of. And they have let everything else go, and they're ready right now to let this go. It may very well be, if you advise them to take this to a lawyer or their doctor, somebody who has a privilege, who is immune from testifying, that they'll never get done. And so you have to balance it out. I mean, our primary concern has to be for the person we're helping. And something like that can keep them from ever recovering, because it's such a cancerous thing, you know, it's eating them alive. Self-preservation says, don't tell me. Maybe being a good sponsor, you have to hear it. I would never say to you one way or the other. That's a decision we all have to make.
You would still be a good sponsor, even if you did advise that person.
Assuming that they ultimately do that, yes. That's the danger. You don't know whether that's going to happen or not. Perhaps you want to monitor it. Perhaps you want to suggest someone to them. Go see Monsignor Riley. He knows all about us, and he won't judge you. He'll just hear you. I'll drive you over to the church, you know. But we have to do our best to make sure it gets done, is my point. So that's a very good point, because it's more and more obvious that the authorities and the courts and the prosecutors out there and the cops know that in AA we learn all about each other, and that we're a rich vein of knowledge, because we have no protection. And if we refuse to testify, we get thrown in prison for contempt, which is what happened to me.
Well, I can see, you know, that where someone may be hesitant to take on someone as a sponsee with a questionable background because they don't want to hear that. So I think it's best that they take on that person who just mentioned that and maybe even assist them.
Okay. It's an excellent suggestion. I hope that what I said makes sense to you, though, that sometimes we have to put ourselves second and this person we're trying to help first. If we can't assure ourselves that this is going to come out with some human being, we probably better go ahead and listen to it. I know I have two sponsees who committed murder. That was a long time ago, but nevertheless, this was something that either they were going to get that out or they were going to drink again. And both of them had families and children in the families. I mean, it was a decision that had to be made. I didn't want to hear it. I had a pretty fair idea what they were driving at. But on the other hand, I didn't think they were ever going to tell anybody else. So it may have been foolish, Sue, I don't know, but it's the way I look at it. I would never tell you, you must do that, or anyone else in here. That's the way I look at it. Yes, ma'am?
What do you think about, I'm sitting there thinking that our personal relations and sex relations are not as different as they were back in 1935.
No, this stuff never changes, are you kidding?
Well, I mean, it's a difference between there's sex relations and there's personal relations with other people, but they're getting less and less different as time goes by.
What are you postulating here? Some kind of an androgynous individual?
Where's this world going, Tim?
Crazy. Go back to sleep.
I don't know why.
Help him out, will you, Debbie?
I give up on him.
Now then, holy cow, I don't know where these are, this hour and a half goes. When we come back next week, we're going to finish this up. And one of the things we're going to attack is this notion that you're not supposed to have a relationship for a year after you come in the program. We're going to see that it's directly contrary to Big Book. Directly contrary to the absolutely consistent position taken in the Big Book, that we take these matters to God, that it's not up to any other human being to decide for us how we should conduct ourselves in our sex lives. We'll also be looking next week at the question of forgiveness. How do we obtain forgiveness? And some people like to think in terms of already being forgiven and forever forgiven. I guess most of us probably feel that if we continue to do the same stuff we've been doing, we'd be real lucky to get forgiven. Now, we're not talking about by other people now, we're talking about forgiven by God. In any event, we've got the formula for doing that, what we need to do to assure forgiveness, and we'll see that that carries over for us into our 11th step as well. And then we'll look at some more of the solution to our sex drive and our sex instincts and this imperious urge. And then finally, we'll look to see what we need to do to finish up our fourth step and be ready to work our fifth step. So we'll do that when we come back next Saturday. I plan to be here, God willing, the creek don't rise. I hope you will be too. And do we have anyone who wants to pick up a chip today? Somebody new or somebody with 3 months, 6 months, or 9 months? Oh yeah, we got to pay the rent. And do we have anyone who wants to pick up a chip today? Somebody new or somebody with 3 months, 6 months, or 9 months? Oh yeah, we got to pay the rent. One hop. Tommy, take care of the money, will you? Oh, yeah. Exact opposite. Contrary really means if you said the sun is going to rise today, I'd say no, it's not. Or if you're going to say it's a sunny day outside, I'm going to say no, it's overcast. That's contrary.
But when you said directly contrary to the big book, what do you say?
I'm saying that idea that we are to be advised not to have any sexual relationships for a year after sobriety is contrary, directly opposite to what the big book tells us. It doesn't tell us to go do it. It tells us to seek God's input before we do it. But not this is not something that human beings are to make up their minds for us. Yes, Deb.
Jim, on a personal note, my therapist told me that I'm not allowed to be, even though I'm married 20 years, a relationship. For the first year, she said, AA tells you, Debbie, you're not allowed to be in it. I said, and I remember what you said from the last time you said it. I said, can you please, and she's in the program, can you please show me where it says that in the big book? And she wasn't able, she said, it says that. It doesn't say that. Where does it say? Jim, is it in the big book that it says?
Of course not. It's only in one place in the literature.
Where is that?
Living Sober.
That's what I thought it was, Living Sober.
Which is a total travesty. By its own admission, doesn't have anything to do with the big book or the steps. It's purely human solution.
I thought it didn't say that in the big book.
No. You'll find it in there somewhere. It also tells us in the Living Sober that only women can sponsor women and only men can sponsor men. That was just pure stupidity. Look right behind you. See Marty Mann over there?
Yeah.
How did she ever get sober?
A man had a sponsor.
She was the first woman.
Yeah.
I mean, look, we get involved in some of the most absurd stuff, and it gets repeated so often everybody simply believes it's true. And it sounds maybe right, I don't know. We can come up with all kinds of rationalizations for it. But where is that in the big book? Where's God in the equation?
I heard a lady in a meeting once say, when talking about that, she said, we're not here to be the arbiter of anybody's sexual conduct. She was talking about relationships and saying that it doesn't say that in the big book.
Oh, it doesn't?
That it doesn't say not. She was agreeing with you about no relationship. She said it might be a good suggestion, but she said, we are not here to be the arbiter of anyone's sexual conduct.
It isn't even, why would you suggest that to somebody when it goes directly against what you're trying to teach them out of the book? we turn in all things to the Father of light. We haven't reached it yet, but right in this next paragraph, it tells us that when we have a problem like that, we take it to God. We ask Him in our morning meditations what we ought to do about each specific matter, and the right answer will come if we want it. That's the solution. Got it? Okay. Anybody want to pick up a chip today? Anybody have an AA birthday this month? Okay. Any announcements for the good of AA? I want to welcome you to the sponsorship workshop here at the Pompano Beach Group of Alcoholics Anonymous. My name is Jim. I'm an alcoholic. Hi, everybody. I'm glad to see you here today.